said, then he went to الشيخ عبد اللطيف آل الشيخ and he said to him, I cannot stay in this place, الأحساء, you know, because the enemies are many, you know, enemies of the Sunnah and this. And the Sheikh is very apparent and very brave when he's given his da'wah. He's لا يخشى في الله لومة لائم. Doesn't fear anybody. He just gives his da'wah and you will see that in his life. So he went to the ministry there and he spoke to Hassan al-Sheikh, another one from the family of al-Sheikh, from the يعني family of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah. And he was a companion to me, he was a good friend to me, Hassan al-Sheikh. He used to always come to me in Egypt when I would be in Egypt. And he said to me, why don't you go to Medina al-Munawwara, يعني Medina al-Nabawiyya. We have just opened up a mahad there, you go there inshallah. And so that was, you know, it was brought up as a decree, and alhamdulillah, they went, he was able to go to Medina, because in Ahsa they have many Shias as well. At that time there were some people calling to يعني, but they were يعني well contained, their da'wah was well contained. The da'wah of Ahlul Sunnah, knowledge of Ahlul Sunnah is very strong. When it spreads, it spreads with knowledge. Then he went to, he says, Sha'Allah fi sanat 1318 intaqaltu mudarrisan fi ma'ahad al-mu'allimin wa ja'a al-shaykh Abdul Aziz bin Baz rahimullah. So initially when he went to Medina, he didn't straight away go to the jami'ah. They put him in a ma'had, ma'had al-mu'allimin. It's like a teacher training place where you're training teachers in the field of Islamic studies. And something I've left behind in, something I didn't mention in Ahsa, he also taught some of the books like Amdat al-Ahkam and Aqid al-Wasitiyya. So in ma'had al-mu'allimin, I was teaching there, I began teaching my year there. Then Sheikh bin Baz rahimullah came to me and he said, look, we need you to come to the Jami'ah. Because in the Jami'ah Islamiyah, they have many foreign students, they come. Especially in the Thanawi, in the secondary, before they go into the university, higher level, they have two years or so, or 3 years, just for Thanawi. يعني, they learn some of the books like Umdat al-Ahkam, Al-Wasitiyya, Lugha Arabiyya. And he said, look, we need you to come to and teach in the Thanawi. So he agreed because he speaks some English as well, so he's able to converse with the Tulab. And in that Thanawi, he met Sheikh Wasiullah, who's now teaching in the Haram. And if you go to Haram al-Makki, and you go to Bab al-Umrah, you'll see there Sheikh Wasiullah teaches Wednesday, Thursday, teaches Sahih al-Bukhari. One of the scholars. So he said he was there in a Thanawi and I taught him in a Thanawi. And also he was allowed to speak in Haram, in Medina. Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna also would be given dawah in Haram in Medina. Like you see now, if you go to Medina, you see many seats which are reserved for the Ahlul Ilm, for the scholars, and they'll be allowed to teach some of the books of Ahlul Sunnah from there. But he says, after in Haram in Medina, I would be talking to the people, because some of them would be doing aspects of shirk. Instead of facing the Qibla and making dua, they're facing the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's qabr and making dua. So he would tell him, this is wrong, this is this, until they try to cause some problem for him in the Masjid al-Nabawi. And he stayed there anyway for about 3 years, because the contract of teachers in Jami Islamiyah is about 3 years. Then he said, I went to he got transferred, he went to Jeddah, he chose to stay in Jeddah. And from Jeddah he said, I did not leave any mosque except that I would be going there giving da'wah in this masjid. Yani showing the excess of da'wah that he used to be given in Jeddah. And also in Haram and Makki, he was given a seat there as well, and he started teaching there in Haram and Makki until a period of time. But he had some difficulty, because now he was not a Saudi, he had some difficulty. So Qadr Allah, he got the jinsiyah. And the story of how he got the jinsiyah is an amazing story. When he went to Taif one time, and they were celebrating at that time a celebration of one of the at that time, who was it? Malik Faisal, was it? Let me just Malik Saud, one of the kings at that time, Malik Saud rahimahullah. he was ill, and then he got better, and so the people started celebrating that Friday, Thursday night until Friday. So in Taif, he was there on Friday. He prayed Jum'ah with one of the mashayikh there, and this sheikh said to him, "Come, you lead the prayer." He said, "Come, give a speech after the Jum'ah. Give it a little kalima." So he said, "I started speaking about this hafla that they're doing." He said, "You know how this is against the sunnah, all night music. This is what is this?" He said, "After," he said, "while I'm talking, I believe that they're going to send me home." But he said, "I continued." And afterwards, he said, Malik Saud found out that he gave this kalima. He said, "Who is this person?" He said, "He's Muhammad al-Banna." He says, "We'll give him the jinsiyah." This is how he got the jinsiyah. "We'll give him the nationality. For indeed he has spoken the truth, and we need more people like him." And this shows you how a person makes tawakkul of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his lifetime. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him. He doesn't fear the people. He only follows the haqq and stays closely to the Ahlul Ilm. So then the rest of his life he stayed in Jeddah. And طبعاً there were many things that happened in Medina. That was the same year that Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani was teaching in Medina, rahimahullah. So he called Sheikh Muhammad al-Albani and said, "These were the golden years. We used to go out in trips, take some of the students and take them out, you know, different areas and teach them. Like for the weekend, we'll go to this masjid and this and just teach them." And طبعاً there's Ahlul Ilm teaching, not like Jama'at Tabligh. Anyone come in and teaching. It wasn't like that. They are teaching them. He said, "Yeah, we did some exercise as well together." And amongst the students at that time who used to come out with us, Sheikh Rabi' ibn Hadi al-Madkhali, Hafidhahullah, and from amongst all the students as well, Sheikh Muhammad Amman al-Jami, rahimahullah, and also from those, but later on they became astray, like Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq and Umar al-Ashqar. These are some of the students who later on they became astray, but they were from those who attended and listened to some of his lectures. And then the Sheikh, in fact, he spends about a whole page just talking about Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq and his misguidance and how he went astray. That was he says, فَصَدَرَ أَمْرُ بِالتَّرْحِيرِ. He said, during the last year of Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq's life, he and a mob of people, they gathered together and they wanted to smash some of the shops that have mannequins in them. They brought mannequins and they wanted to smash these shops, meaning enjoining good and forbidden evil with their own hand, even though there's a ruler there with authority. And you're going, "This is not allowed." Enjoining good and forbidden evil, yes, but if you have authority to do it with your hand, do it. If you don't have authority, then it's not in your hands. Upon you is, at least bil kalam, advise the rulers or advise the people in that responsibility. But anyway, this is what happened. So in that last year of his studies, Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq, they said, "Khalas, we will send you home." And he was Egyptian. Now he decided, he said, "I'll go to Qatar." They took him to Qatar, but Qatar got an agreement with Saudi Arabia that whoever comes in will not be, whoever is rejected will not be allowed in. So he couldn't go into Qatar. Then they sent him to Kuwait. And the Kuwait, they thought he was from the biggest Ikhwan al-Muslimin to come to them, a savior. يعني, as Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna says, as though that he's like Muhammad Fatih, a victorious leader coming to save them. Because Abdurrahman ibn Khaliq's relative, or his father, he was in the battle against the Jews in 1947, I think it was, or 19. So they thought that he's khalas, he's one of the people fighting jihad and so on, he's one of those. But anyway, Allahumma sta'an, he stayed in Kuwait and he went astray later on. You know, when they showed him the money, they showed him all of these riches and so on. Later on, he followed that path, the path of trying to bring together Salafiyyah with Ikhwan al-Muslimin, trying to mix the two. And this is not possible. And so he went astray and he's leading other people astray. So Sheikh Muhammad Zahal Akhir, Sheikh Muhammad al-Banna, he talked about that towards the end of his biography. طبعاً, this is not a complete biography, this is very brief, but inshallah, يعني, I've just given you kind of a summary of the life of Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab Marzuq al-Banna. And until this day, he is known amongst the Ahlul Ilm, and he sits